Christ living undivided right.
You need a strong east wind. You need a strong east wind to blow out your preconceived ideas. You need a strong east wind to blow out your religion. You need a strong east wind to blow out the doctrine of the scribes and Pharisees, which still possess your soul because you've not allowed the Holy Ghost to move in you and set you free.
A ministry with a vision. A ministry on the move. A ministry established by our faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Think what God wants to do in his people is make his supernatural Holy Ghost fire and power clear to our sight, clear to our mind, so that there is no doubt in our spiritual creation who God is.
Bible for Christ Love International Ministry, a ministry with a vision built on a plan. God.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. How many of you are excited to be here this Sunday afternoon, ready to get into that fire of God? I am so excited. From the beginning of this morning when we walked in here for Spanish service, you could feel the power and the presence of the Lord. I'm excited about all the things God is getting ready to do here at Revival for Christ Club International Ministries. It is an exciting time, and I just want to encourage you. I talked to our apostles this morning, and they send their greetings to you. They're on their way back. They'll be back with us next Sunday, and I just encourage every single one of you, next Sunday, come ready. Come ready to praise the Lord. Come ready to hear all the exciting things that God is getting ready to do in our ministry. It is an exciting time. That's why it's so important that the people of God, the men and women of God, go up on that mountaintop to hear from God. Amen. Hallelujah. So we are going to get blessed next Sunday, but it's going to be a blessing today because we're all together in the house of the Lord. Are you ready for a powerful experience with God today? Amen. Let's just lift up our hands and get ready for what God has today. Father, in the name of Jesus, oh, we are grateful to you, God. Oh, to feel, God, your precious anointing. Oh, that we can feel, Father, the refreshing of your spirit, God. Father, we pray right now for service, Lord. Father, we yield ourselves to you. God, we desire to flow in your spirit, to be the people, God, that you've called us to be. I pray right now, God, let every vessel be open to hear your word today. Let every vessel be ready to give and offer up a worship and a praise to you, that all of heaven will rejoice. Let your fire have your way tonight. Today, Father, we glorify and lift up your holy name. We ask all these things in the mighty name of Jesus. We pray. Amen and amen. Well, come up. Get out of those seats. Stand up to your feet and give God all the praise. He's worthy. Oh, yes, Father, we want that roar to sound through the air, God. Oh, that your Holy Ghost would move. That every bit of flesh, God, oh, would be silent in your presence, God. That you would receive all the glory, oh, and all the praise. Begin to let that wind begin to blow. Begin to let this presence, oh, Yandara, just lift up your hands. Just surrender to the Lord right now. Just begin to seek him right now. Hallelujah. Oh, yes, we're getting ready. We're getting ready to be in that place where the Holy Ghost is going to blow through this place. Oh, yeah.
Temperature is rising. I can Suddenly, the atmosphere changes. Suddenly, the spirit starts raining. Suddenly, I feel the wind blowing. It's coming in, it's coming in. Suddenly, the atmosphere changes. Suddenly, the spirit starts raining. Suddenly, I feel the wind blowing. It's coming in, it's coming in.
It's coming in,
it's coming in.
It's coming in,
it's coming in. It's coming in,
it's coming in,
it's coming in,
oh yeah,
it's coming in, it's coming in.
There's an utterance of word filling every mouth like flames of fire. It started pouring out. For these are not the drunken we suppose. But don't you be mistaken. It's just the power of the Holy Ghost.
Suddenly, the atmosphere changes. Suddenly, the spirit starts raining. Suddenly, I feel the wind blowing. It's coming in, it's coming in. Suddenly, the atmosphere changes. Suddenly, the spirit starts raining. Suddenly, I feel the wind blowing. It's coming in, it's coming in.
It's coming in,
it's coming in,
it's coming in,
it's coming in,
oh yes,
it's coming in,
it's coming in,
oh yes, Lord.
Right here. Oh God, we worship you. Father, we praise you. Father, our eyes are upon you, God. Oh yes, just center, make him the center of your moment right now. Center in on him.
Alamasi. Oh yes, just let His Spirit move. Oh, we welcome You right now, Holy Ghost. Oh, Yabalamasi, begin to prepare us, Lord. Begin to prepare us for what You have. Oh, Yabalamashadarabaki.
Oh, yes, Lord. Oh, we're so grateful to You, Father. We're so thankful that we can feel that breath of God upon us. Aren't You thankful that You walked into this place, that You came today, and that You can feel the breath of God upon You? Oh yes, that's exactly what the people need, is that breath of the Lord. Oh, glory to His name. He's worthy to be praised. Amen. Oh, thank You, Jesus. I am so glad to be a part of a ministry that lets the Spirit of the Lord move freely and willingly. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, welcome to Sunday service here at Revival for Christ Club International Ministries, where the Holy Ghost has His way. Amen. I hope you came ready, because I feel the fire of God. Amen. We have a special, but I don't know what it is. So I'm just, it's a Winds of Flag Fire, Winds of Fire team, and they're going to come do a special for you today.
Fixing my eyes on a new horizon. Joy before me, leave the past behind. There's no turning back, there's no turning back. Only I run into Your presence, faith like a child, known and protected. Here in Your arms, my shame is unraveled.
No time.
to praise the Lord today. Amen. Let's all go ahead and stand up to our feet. I don't want to take up too much time. I am excited today to be able to come and to hear the word of God being spoken by this young man of God. I am excited about how the Lord speaks to him. And I know every time that I've heard him speak, it is a direct hit to our heart. Amen. So without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and bring up the man of God, chosen by God, and spoke by the our apostles to bring forth this man, young man of God. He's MC and on his road to becoming a licensed minister. I'm so excited for Mario Johnson to break forth the word of God today. God bless
you. Hallelujah. Who's excited to be in the house of God today? Oh, come on. I think we can do just a little bit better than that. I believe that I'm standing on RFC ground. I believe I'm standing on some holy ground. It's time to kick off your shoes and stay a while. I don't know about you, but I want some word. I want the anointing. I want the Holy Ghost to stir up all up in this building. I don't want to stay in the pew. I don't want to stay stagnant, but I want to go forward in the body of Christ. And I need to know if there's some RFC folk in here that want to press forward, if they want to see the Holy Ghost move in this place. Hallelujah. Let's go before the Lord in a word of prayer. Thank you so much, Father God, for this amazing opportunity. We're asking that your healing oil would begin to flow like a river in this building, that every person that would come close to the river would feel healing oil today. I believe that your spirit is already in here and that your holy fire is dwelling with us. So we ask that we are willing vessels to be burned in the fire. We're asking right now that you begin to pour out a fresh word and a fresh manna from heaven that would hit your people. Not my words, Father. Not my ideas or opinions. We rebuke any attack of the enemy. We rebuke sickness. We rebuke disease. We rebuke any mental health. We know we serve a mighty God who can heal me, who can heal us. And we proclaim the name of Jesus right now. We love you so much, and we just want to have an encounter with you. Let's not get in a rush right now. Just proclaim the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, for this amazing day. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody would say amen. Hallelujah. Woo! Well, I'm excited to be in the house of God today because I believe that the fire has already been kindled. And it's already been sparked today. Now, God told me today, I have this message. I had it since Sunday, last Sunday. But the Lord, he hasn't changed the message, but he's changed the point and the direction of the message. God says that there's people in here today that need a healing, not just physically, but in their mind, in their spirit. There are some people who's been giving in to sickness and disease and who've been giving in to the enemy's lies and depression and anxiety. But I need somebody to raise up out of that and get into the present. And I am a messenger to you today to tell you that my God is a healer. My God is a deliverer. And I want to let you know that you're standing in the right place. If you need healing, if you need a touch from the Lord, you came to the right place. Without further ado, let's get right into the message. Please go to Ezekiel 9. And I just want to thank our apostles today, because without them, without our visionary, we wouldn't even be able to stand in this building and get opportunity to preach. I believe that there's people in here raising up to be men and women of God, and we have to give honor to the Lord and also to the men and women that poured into us in order for us to have opportunity. So again, we just say thank you, God, for our chief apostle and Apostle Jenny, that they have poured out to us and moves forward in the vision today. So I'm so grateful for them. And then also our leadership who's in the house today. Let's give a hand to them, because I believe that we have an amazing leadership. And amazing men and women that don't come in here to give their opinion or their personal ideas, but to give you the word of God infused with the Spirit of God. So we want to thank all of you guys today. And thank you, MC John Crandall, for coming up in here in the building today. We love you so much. And we appreciate all of your obedience and your sacrifice. Everything that you, everything that you've been through and you stuck to it and you stuck to the plan of God. We give you honor today. We give you honor today and the Lord inside of you. We thank the Lord for blessing us with an MC such as John Crandall, because he is a man of God. He is a warrior to this vision. And we appreciate everything that you've poured into this ministry. So Ezekiel chapter 9, and we're going to, this is kind of going to be a more of a simple message. So, but it's okay, because the word of God always hits us, whether it's, you know, one of the basic messages or whether it's really revelational. But today, I hope you get something out of this in Ezekiel 9. Oh my gosh, I know I had a great time with the Lord. So let's start in verse 1. It said, "He cried also in mine ears with a loud voice, saying, cause them that have charge over the city to draw near, even every man with his destroying weapon in his hand." So I just want to take this a little bit slow today. Excuse me, where it says, "He cried also in my ears with a loud voice." With a loud voice. I remember Apostle Jenny spoke a message on Ezekiel 9, and she said, anytime that the Lord wants to speak to you with a loud voice, he's trying to get your attention. And God told me to come here as a messenger to get the attention of the body of Christ today. Let me read exactly what God had me type out. He says, "This theater belongs to God. Stop worrying. Leave it in the hands of God." And this may sound a little funny, but this is exactly what he told me to write down. He said, "Have you ever seen money pulled out of the thin air? Well, I have." And I don't know, I don't have the weight of the ministry finances on me. But one thing I can assure you is that Jesus died on the cross for you to stop worrying. Each time you worry, you crucify Jesus on the cross again, afresh. Stop worrying about the finances. Stop worrying about the success of this theater. I'm coming to tell you today that this theater is in the palm of God's hand. Just as you saw Revival for Christ Club in his palm, that means the theater too. The Yellow Rose Dinner Theater belongs to the Lord. Doesn't belong to a man. You can come against. You can try to speak against. But one thing I can assure you is that God will have his way at the end of the day. Sometimes it's hard to hear God's voice speak loudly in our ear when we've got distractions clogging our ears. And these are some things that God told me that has creeped its way into the body of Christ today. And I'm just going to speak on it. This is kind of different, but I'm going to attack these things exactly how the Lord told me. There are three of them. One is fear and anxiety. They're the same thing, fear and anxiety. We like to blame things on our anxiety. We like to say, oh, my anxiety was really bad today, so I had to get fleshy today. My anxiety was going crazy, so I had to go speak gossip and bad things about people. I'm sorry, Lord, that I did this. You've been saying sorry for 20 years. It's time to get out of that anxiety. Get out of that fear. That is not of the Lord. He has not given you the spirit of fear, but of peace, love, and a sound mind. It's time to get a sound mind. It's time to get into the presence of the Lord. You were not called to be a body of anxiety. And number two is depression. Depression has seeped its way very slyly in the body of Christ. In this people today, I don't know who I'm talking to, but one thing I can assure you is that I heard God say that depression has been trying to weigh heavy on some people. And even if you know it or you don't, depression has tried to tie onto you. But it's time right now to allow the Holy Ghost to manifest in you and allow the hand of God to become and upon you and press you. It's time to get out of depression. And the third one is sickness. I don't want to offend nobody, but this is exactly what the Lord told me. He said, fear, anxiety, depression, and sickness. And he told me, he said, depression can lead into sickness. Because when you're at home with no one around, depression starts to speak. And it says, you're not worthy. Matter of fact, stay home because you're not feeling well. No one's going to miss you today. You've been gone so long, they don't love you anymore. I'm just attacking what the enemy's trying to lie to you about. The enemy's been lying to some people, and I'm not going to have it. The Lord spoke to me about it, and it's my job to do something about it. No, I'm not your Savior, but I will tell you about the Savior, which is Jesus, Jesus Christ. I'm going to get some scripture out to you, Isaiah 54 and 14. You don't have to go there, but I do want to have this in the forefront of your mind. It says, in righteousness shalt thou be established. Thou shalt be far from oppression, for thou shalt not fear, and from terror shall it not come near thee. What I love about that scripture is that it says, I shall be established in righteousness. When you're established in righteousness, you won't get controlled and overtaken by depression or oppression or terror. If you find yourself in a depressed state, it's probably because you're not established in righteousness. And we've had an amazing message on The Roar where it's righteous, overcoming, anointed, revelation. And I love that first song they sung, which is Restore the Roar. Maybe we need to go back to that because some of us have slipped out of righteousness and therefore depression has made its way inside of our lamp. It's taken the place where the oil should be in our lamp, but the depression has been there. It's time that we get out of depression because that will be a backslide to you. And when you backslide, I backslide. When you succeed, I succeed. So it's time that all of us get together in one mind, one accord, and we rise up against depression and oppression. Somebody, I want you. When are we going to start getting up and rising up and speak to ourselves? Many times we want to speak behind the pulpit, but in our living room, we're staying silent. In our bedroom, we're staying silent. When are you going to speak up in your living room? When are you going to speak up when you're alone, with no one around? I want to tell you today, get up out of that depression. I need somebody to roar, 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 roar. Woo. I want to testify because many of you guys know I have asthma, and it's been something since I was, I believe, born. I don't know. I don't, can't remember that far back. But I've been struggling with asthma my entire life, and it's hard to breathe. And nobody knows this except my mom and my roommates now. Every morning, my asthma attacks me. Every morning, the enemy tries to hold me down with that asthma. And he tries to get me out of the plan of the Lord and the will of the Lord. And he says, your asthma is too bad today. You can't make it to theater. You can't make it to the work. You can't make it to go to a fellowship. But do you know what I have to do? Because let me tell you one thing. No inhaler is going to stop. No inhaler is going to save me. No inhaler is going to save me. It's the Lord Jesus Christ that I have to lean on. And I have to rely on the Lord to breathe breath inside of these lungs. And every day I have to say, no, devil, you will not have these lungs. I do not belong to you. I belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm not saying that for you to sympathize for me. Sympathizing for flesh is a wasted emotion. I want you to sympathize for Jesus because he died on the cross, yet you're still in sickness. He died on the cross, yet you are still battling with things you've been dealing with for 20 years. Don't get me wrong. There are some things that God has you going through for you to be a testimony. But you know what I mean. There are some of us who use it as an excuse for way too long. And I'm not trying to point fingers, but I'm telling you that God is bigger. God is bigger. God is greater than any sickness. Where is your faith? Psalms 91, 4 through 5. You don't got to go there, but I just want to establish some things in you before we get into the depth of this message. Psalms 91, 4 through 5. It says, he shall cover thee with his feathers. When's the last time you've been under his feathers? When his wings have covered you, because the wings of the Lord, that eagle's wings, have always been there. But you sometimes like to slip away from it because we're scared of getting loved by the Lord. We're scared of really getting intimate in His presence. Maybe because somebody abused you, or maybe it's because somebody misused you. But I want to be a messenger to you today and tell you it doesn't have to be that way. You can get intimate with the Lord. He will not hurt you. He will not hurt you. He will pick you up and put you back on a firm foundation. He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and thy buckler. Listen to this. This kind of got me. In verse 5, thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor the arrow that flieth by day. So terror by night and arrow that flieth to kill you by day. Doesn't that sound kind of familiar? Another scripture, Exodus 13, 21 through 22. And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of a cloud to lead them the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light to go day and night. Maybe we're in terror and fear and anxiety because we haven't gotten close to the fire. We haven't gotten close to that cloud manifestation. It's time that we go back to the basics. Go back to the revelational knowledge that has been poured out over this pulpit. The cloud wants to manifest before you, and the fire wants to burn before you. Because I'm telling you, that terror has no hold on you. That fear and oppression has nothing on the people of God. You have authority. Let's continue. It says, he cried in Ezekiel 9 in verse 1. He cried also in mine ears with a loud voice, saying, cause them that have charge over the city to draw near, even every man with his destroying weapon in his hand. Whoa. Okay, so this is what got me. The charge over the city. So these men that God is calling and crying out in Ezekiel's ears to come forth, he wants them to only those who have charge over the city to draw near. God told me, if I were to ask you who had charge over your city, what would appear? Because you have to respond to the voice of the Lord, whether you want to or not. But he's giving you a chance. When he asks, what has charge over your city? Let them draw near. What's going to come out? Is it going to be oppression and depression or sickness or something else? Or do you have charge over depression and sickness? Do you take authority over that depression? I don't know who I'm talking to. And I know some of y'all looking at me crazy, but I know that the Lord wants you to get up out of that mess. Get up out of that grave. It's the camp trying to pull you back in. God wants you to dwell with Him in the tabernacle. God is calling for the men who have authority and charge over the city. Oh, Ricky, honorable Sita, and who is the strong man in your house? Mark 3 and 27 talks about the only way that you can overtake a house is if you overtake the strong man. So who is that strong man in your house? Is it the Holy Spirit? Is it the Holy Spirit, or is it something in you? Is it that sickness that I talked about earlier? Because God wants the strong man to come inside of you, the Holy Ghost to stir up inside of you and to move out all of that hurt and pain that you've been held on to for a long time. And we forget sometimes we have dominion. Genesis 1 and 28. This is the hope that I want to give you today. Because, yes, I'm talking about those who may have fallen back into depression, fear, anxiety, and sickness. But let me tell you, there's hope. God doesn't, you know what I'm saying? He doesn't just tell you that you're in this and then leave you alone. No, He helps you through it. He puts out His hand and says, my hand is inviting you to come with me. It's up to you to accept it or not. So here's your hope today. Genesis 1 and 28, it says, and God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowls of the air and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. You have dominion. You have charge and authority over everything that's on this earth. Anything that tries to move you into out of the presence of God, you have authority. You have dominion. It's up to you to unlock the dominion and authority by coming into the church house and getting blessed by the Lord, getting filled up with His anointing and refreshed in His oil. And I want to break down the fish of the sea and the fowls of the air just really quickly. This is what the Lord told me. The fish of the sea. their past mistakes that God has cast into the sea of forgetfulness, but somehow they seem to swim their way back onto the shore. God has cast it out to the sea of forgetfulness, but somehow you're over there fishing, ready for it to come back and to partake of your past mistakes. God says, you don't have to do that. It's not up to you to look for the things that you've done in the past, because when he throws it in the sea of forgetfulness, it should stay there. The only person that can go back and get it is you, but you have to be willing to step away from that sea and get it to the river of anointing, get it to the oil, get it to the presence of the Almighty God. He doesn't want you fishing for your past mistakes. I know it can be hard when you did something in the past and all of a sudden your mind, the enemy starts to tell you, oh, Chief Apostle, they only see you for your mistake that you made. Anytime you walk into the room, everybody sees the mistake that you made. No, that is a lie from the enemy. That is a lie straight from the pits of hell. And I'm going to tell you, you can throw that thought back where it came from, in the pits of hell. In the pits of hell, the enemy belongs in hell, not dwelling in your living room. Moving on to the fowls of the air. The fowls of the air belong to the prince of the air. The fowls are what he dangles over your head and uses against you. Those things that seem to hover over you for so long. In other words, your triggers. The fowls of the air are the triggers that the enemy uses against you. And sometimes what we like to do, and it's just, I'm just bringing recognition and acknowledgement to some of the ways that the enemy tries to get you. Sometimes we have a button or a trigger, and we're like, but God, they pushed my button. They triggered me. And then we like to blame everybody else. You triggered me. So I have a good reason to be fleshy. I have a good reason to gossip about you. But if you didn't have the button, they couldn't press it. If you didn't have the trigger, they couldn't use it against you. So maybe it's time to turn the mirror back on ourselves and say, God, remove this foul out of my space. Remove this trigger out of my space, because I serve a God who is better, stronger, and greater than any fowl of the air. Let's go to Genesis 15 real quick. The Spirit is good today, and we just got to follow his way. Yes, 15 and verse 9, it says, and he said unto him, this is the Lord speaking to Abraham, he said unto him, take me an heifer of 3 years old, and she goat of 3 years old, and a ram of 3 years old, and a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. In verse 10, it says, and he took unto him all these things, and divided them in the midst, and laid each piece one against another, but the birds divided he not. And this is what it says in verse 11. And when the fowls came down upon the carcasses, Abram drove them away. It's always when you're being obedient to the Lord that the fowls of the air will seem to swoop down and try to mix into your sacrifices and mix into your obedience and mix into the will of the Lord. But Abram drove them away. God could have easily done it, but it was up to Abram to say, I'm still going to be obedient. Whether the triggers try to come to me or not, I'm going to be obedient. Whether the fowls of the air try to dangle above me or not, I'm going to be obedient to the will of the Lord. And I'm going to use my authority and drive them away. Drive them away. Who will drive all those fowls away? There's some of you in this building. We got to take a pause. There's somebody here today. You're looking at me and saying, Mario, you don't know me. You don't know my situation. You don't know what I've been going through. But can I tell you something? Jesus knows. Jesus knows. It's not me. It's not me. It's not me who's trying to get up in your business. I'm not called to do that. I don't even want to get in your business. I got my own business to take care of. But Jesus will get in your business if he wants to. Jesus knows how much healing you need, and he's right here today. The man in the white linen wants to heal you, and you have to be open to it. And here is your opportunity to stop being so stony-hearted and to open up your walls and break them down. You're still doing it, but I'm telling you right now, it's your opportunity. It's your time to get in the presence of the Lord. Because I remember a message Minister Karen spoke just last, I believe the Sunday before last, in Ezekiel 2 or 3, where it says, you're going to speak to a rebellious nation. Whether they hear it or not is up to them. But they shall surely know a prophet entered the building. I'm not saying I'm a prophet, but I will tell you that the man of God, the man of the white linen, wants to heal you today. He wants to touch you and mark you in this moment. And it's up to you to open your ears and to hear it today. We'll see. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We can go back to Ezekiel 9. And while you go there, I want to read this scripture to you because it's really good. Matthew 8 and 20, this is what it says. Matthew 8 and 20, and Jesus said unto him, the foxes have holes, and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath nowhere to lay his head. The foxes have holes to sleep and rest in. The birds of the air, they have their nests in your land where they can reside. But for some reason, the Son of Man has no place to rest in your temple, in your tabernacle. The little foxes that spoil the vine have residence in your temple. The fowls of the air, the triggers, have residence in your temple. But the Son of God has nowhere to rest. The Son of God is trying to see where he can reside in your tabernacle. But he has nowhere to rest. It's up to you to make room. Make room. Get rid of those foxes and get rid of the fowls of the air. You say, but how do I do that? Activate dominion. It's in Genesis. Activate dominion. There's somebody I need you right now just to activate your dominion, activate your authority. God wants you to get up, get up, get up. The man in white linen wants to rest in your tabernacle. He wants to reside in your temple. He wants to be with you. But you've got some stuff blocking his entrance, blocking his entrance. And it's time to take out a vacuum cleaner. Let the Holy Spirit blow. Let the Holy Spirit blow in your temple and allow the man in white linen to reside in your temple. Hallelujah. We have dominion. No more blaming mommy and daddy for what they did to us. No more blaming mommy and daddy for what they did to us. And I know this is getting a little personal, a little real. But sometimes we have these triggers and these fouls, and you know, sickness takes a hold of us and anxiety likes to creep in, and we start to fear about things that we're going through, and we push it aside because we blame it. My mother, she did this to me. My mom, she did this thing to me, and it hurts. It doesn't feel good. I don't have healing for it. My daddy, he abused me. He was never there for me. He did things to me I can't even speak about. But God says, they don't have charge over your city. They don't have authority over your city. I can tell you about a real mama and a real daddy that could take charge, that could take dominion over your city. And I'm talking about the Word, and I'm talking about the Spirit that can come and comfort you in the midnight hour. Roye nanaya, rokiye, rosi. I want to lay hands on you, but the Lord told me no, so it's up to you to get healed by the Lord. It's up to you to get healed by the anointing. It's up to you to get healed right now. What are you waiting for? It's up to you to get healed. Rokia, let it come inside of you. Pastor Chris, I'm going to pull a Karen. Pastor Chris, wave your hand right over there. You see that man of God? Counsel. Counsel. That's all I got to say is counsel. One word for you is counsel. Where have you been? Counsel. Where do you need to be? Counsel. Where does God want to meet you at? Council, 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 council. You've been in it too long. I'm with you. I'm ready for you to get healed. God is ready for you to get healed. And you're still not listening. It's okay. Let's go on. Ezekiel 9. I'm done. Ezekiel 9 and verse 2. Verse 1. I'm sorry. We're still in verse 1. He cried also in mine ears with a loud voice, saying, cause them that have charge over the city to draw near. That's your self-examination time. To look inside of your heart and see what has charge over your city. And it says, even every man with his destroying weapon in his hand. So there was a requirement for the men to draw near. God said, don't let any man that doesn't have charge and doesn't have the destroying weapon in their hand to draw near. Why is that a requirement for us to have in our hands in order to draw near? What is that weapon and why in our hands? Ephesians 6 and 17. And take the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, but it's not just the Spirit. It says the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. That established truth is the destroying weapon that you should be holding inside of your hand. God wants to see the destroying weapon to cut off the head of the fowl and to cut off the head of the fish and get ready to get into the presence of the Lord. You see, what I love about Ephesians 6, if you go read it, that's the whole armor of God. God, we're moving quick, but it's the whole armor of God. And in that whole armor, there's only one weapon. There's only one weapon. And I did a little research because I heard God say it, but I just wanted to make sure it was backed up a little research. Warriors and soldiers and knights back in the Bible days, back in the day, even now, they have more than one weapon with them because their first weapon might break. It might get lost. It might get destroyed. But can I tell you something about the weapon of the Lord? It will never be destroyed. It'll never lose. It'll never get broken. Because it's the Spirit and the Word. It's that equal measure. It's the sword of the Spirit. And the sword of the Spirit will never fail. It's the user of the weapon that fails. It's the user of the weapon that fails, not the weapon. Because the Spirit and the Word, they're eternal elements. God's warriors only need one sword of the Spirit, only one weapon in their hand to come against the enemy. In Matthew 8 and 16, this is just to back this up. Matthew 8 and 16, it says, I love this. When the even was come, they brought unto him, talking about Jesus, many that were possessed with devils, plural. But it says, and he cast out the spirits, plural, with his word, singular. He cast out the devils and the spirits with his word. The devils and the spirits with his word. Come on, somebody. Let the word of God stir up inside of you. Let the word of God destroy depression and rekiai, anything that the enemy's trying to use against you. I'm just a willing messenger to tell you today that God wants you to get out of the mess. He wants you to get out of that stuff that you've been stuck in for a while. You only need one encounter with the Spirit to change your life around. You only need one word from God to change your life around. Oh, rekiai, narrable satai. And I love how it says, destroying weapon in his hand. And this was just so amazing to me when God told me. Because RFC, we need to realize something. And Isaiah 49 and 16 has to be one of my favorite scriptures. It's very simple. But it says, behold, that's Isaiah 49 and 16. Behold, I have graven thee upon the palms of my hand. Thy walls are continually before me. And God reminded me of how we are engraved in his hands. The destroying weapon is in his hands. God said, RFC is my destroying weapon. RFC is my destroying weapon that I'm going to take out to the nations and destroy some flesh, destroy the carnality. He said that RFC, you have to realize that God holds you in his hands to be used as a destroying weapon against the attacks of the enemy. We got to realize that we are special. We are anointed and consecrated for a time like this, for a time like this. God wants you to know that you are more than a conqueror. You're an overcomer. You're a righteous, overcoming, anointed revelators. I need my revelators to stand and to shout and to seek the Lord. Why? Where is the revelation? Okay. Ezekiel 9 and 2. Wow. Ezekiel 9 and verse 2, this is what it says. And behold, six men came from the way of the higher gate, which lieth toward the north, and every man a slaughter weapon in his hand, and one man among them was clothed with linen. We're going to stop there and scoot all the way back up to the beginning of verse 2 where it says, they came from the higher gate. Isaiah 59 and 8 through 9, for the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. You say, that's a basic scripture. Yeah, because God is still the same God as he was yesterday, today, and forevermore. If his ways were higher yesterday, they're going to be higher today. They're going to be higher than your thoughts and your knowledge. But listen to this. I want you guys to go to Isaiah 14 for me, because there was somebody in the Bible that wanted to put their ways higher than the heavens. And Zoe kind of brought this up in her message. I thought it was amazing what the Lord showed me. I mean, it's not revelational because it's right there in the Word. So I want you guys to look Isaiah 14. And we're going to start in verse 12. It's okay. Oh my. Isaiah 14 and 12, it says, how art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? And right here, you'll read this whole thing. How Lucifer wanted to be higher than the stars of heaven, higher than the throne of God. He wanted to exalt himself higher than where the man in the white linen came from. But God called him something in verse 19. 14 and 19, look at this. It says, but thou art cast out of the grave like an abominable branch. He is the abominable branch. When you get pride, you are no longer the branch connected to the vine. You are an abominable branch. Some of us have been walking around in the abominations of Lucifer. It's time to get up out of that and go to the Spirit of God. God wants you to connect it to the vine. Oh, there are two vines that you can be connected to. You're either connected to God or to Jesus. I'm sorry, he's our vine. Or you're connected to the abominable vine, Lucifer. I don't want to be connected to that. I don't want to be connected to depression. I want to be connected to the living Lord. The one who came and saved me. By his stripes we are healed. By his stripes we are healed. We are healed by the blood of the Lamb. By the blood of the Lamb. We've been walking around in hurt and pain, but God wants to heal you. Stop being like the abominable branch and get connected to the vine of Jesus, because it's only by Jesus that we can even have fruit on our branch at all. But sometimes we see no fruit and we're wondering why. And it's kind of like when Jesus passed by the fig tree and there was no figs. There was just fig leaves. Some of the adult Sunday school members might remember, might not, but God told me when Jesus passed by the fig tree and saw no fruit, just the fig leaves, he cursed it. Because it was the same thing that happened in the Garden of Eden. When God looked at his creation, he saw no fruit. He saw fig leaves wrapped around the creation of God to hide their value, to hide their inheritance. And that's why he kicked them out of the garden, because there was no fruit on them. It's time to get some fruit on your branch. How do you do that? John 15 says, no branch can produce fruit of its own, but only through the vine. Let the vine abide in you, and you abide in the vine. Oh, we're almost done here. We're almost done. There's a lot more that God spoke to me. But, we need to follow the Spirit of the Lord. Woo! Let's go to Ezekiel 9 and verse 2. Yep. Which lies toward the north, the higher gate, which lies toward the north. And every man a slaughter weapon in his hand, and one man among them was clothed with linen. He was clothed with linen, with the writer's inkhorn by his side, and they went in and stood beside the brazen altar. When's the last time you stood beside the brazen altar to give up sacrifices to the Lord, to give up and be a willing vessel to the Lord? The brazen altar is open. The altar is open for his people. And God wants to pour out a healing oil. He wants to pour out a healing anointing on his people. But you have to run to the altar. You have to be willing to go to the altar. The Lord says that there's going to be a moment. Later in today's service, not too far from here, but he's giving you time to make up a decision. He said he's going to give you an opportunity to run to the altar and get healing, because there's healing at the altar. There's healing at the altar. There's a river of oil flowing at this altar. And when God opens it, will you run? Will you run? Or will you stay back there in your seat? Will you stay right there in the pew? Or will you run to the brazen altar? The man in the white linen, who is this? This is the main point you want to get to. Who is the man in the white linen? Let me tell you about the man who is in white linen. Here it is. Luke 2 and 7. God told me, who is the only person that we have seen that was swaddled in linen at birth? And then he was buried with linen at death. Oh, I heard somebody say his name, Jesus. And I want you to, we're going to take a pause. I want you to be careful with that name, because there's power in that name. And if you don't really mean to get healed, don't even call on the name of Jesus. If you don't mean to get healed, don't even utter it out of your mouth. You say, Mario, that's harsh. What did Jesus say to disciples? Don't you even talk about me. Don't spread the good news until you be endued with the power from on high with the Holy Ghost. Don't you say his name if you're not endued with the power and if you don't really want healing. But the man in the white linen, Luke 2 and 7, he was born and swaddled in it, in the linen. Matthew 27 and 59 and 60. He was wrapped in linen to go into the grave. And let me tell you, that was the last thing that the people saw, was Jesus wrapped in the white linen. And he even left it for his people. He left it folded nice and neat for you to take part of that linen. So you're telling me that the last thing that this world saw my Savior as was in white linen. This is what God told me. It's because he's coming back in the same linen that people thought he was dead in. And he's telling you that he has never died. He has never died. But he has risen out of that grave in that same linen, signifying his holiness, his harmlessness, his undefiledness. He wants you to get that white linen on you. And this is what God told me. The last thing I can say, I didn't even expect to end on this, but this is what the Lord told me. The enemy thought that they could silence the lion, but they forgot that on that cross was the lamb that was slain. And he's coming back as a lion, roaring. He wants you to have the revelation. He wants you to be an overcomer with the anointing.
He wants you to have the revelation. Where is your roar? Why? He came as a roaring lion of Judah. So where is your roar? If he died on the cross for you to roar, where is your roar? Why is it not here? Why do we not see it in the churches? Why do we not see it today? The man in the white linen wants to roar today. He wants to roar today inside of you. Lift up your hands before the Lord today. We're going to get into the presence of God real quick. Oh, Rekiye, Naranobo Setai. Dario, I need you on the piano. I need JJ with me. Oh, Rekiye, Naranobo Setai. God wants a healing oil to be placed inside of you. Hey, Rokoroke, Rokiyande, Rossi, Riai. God says, oh, Rekiye, that the altar is open for anybody that needs a healing touch from the man in the white linen. Not me, not a man, but the man in the white linen that has opened his heart for healing. Oh, right now, just surrender to the Lord. Take notice of what has charge over your city. Take notice over what has charge over your city. God wants to pour out a healing oil. Oh, Reiki. Let him refresh you right now. Let him refresh you right now. Let that healing oil, let that healing oil refresh you. Refresh you. In the name of Jesus, you are healed. You are healed. You are healed right now. God wants you to walk in your healing. Walk in your healing. Rokie, Rocio. The enemy has no place in your tabernacle. You are a child of the living God. And he's pouring a refreshing oil. Refresh, refresh, refresh. Oh, Randana will see. Yeah, Narana will coronai. Oh, ho, ho. Oh, Suzanne. Huh? I feel the oil that God is wanting to pour on you. But God wants to know if you're ready for it. See, there may have been things that have been hindering you. There may have been fowls that were trying to hover over your head. But you have dominion. Huh? You have authority. Huh? And the oil of God is about to pour over your life. Right now, in the name of Jesus, God wants to heal you in the name of Jesus. Hey, Narandalabo Setai. Oh, Narandalabo Sie. Oh, Ranai Henano. Hiande. The man in the white linen wants to come to you. He wants to mark you on your head. Oh, he wants to see you with that linen on you. And God says, I'm healing you. I'm healing you in the name of Jesus. My mark on your forehead is not just a mark, but it produces oil every time the enemy tries to come to you. I want you to speak out of your mouth and say, no, devil, I serve a mighty God, and he is my healer. He is my deliverer right now in the name of Jesus. Healing, healing over this mind. Healing over this mind. Healing over this mind. I rebuke the enemy's ties and lies right now in the name of Jesus. I see oil on your hand, and you're going to use it. You're going to use it for yourself, and the day will come when you'll use it for others as well. Thank you. to heal you. He wants to heal you right now. See, your heart has been broken too many times. And you've came to the point where you're like, when is it gonna end? But God says, I'm with you, daughter. Your heart belongs to me, says the Lord. No man can break it because he didn't form it. No man can break you because they didn't make you. Only the Lord God can heal you because he made you in the palm of his hands. I see healing right here. I see oil right here. I see healing on your ears. Healing on your ears. Because you've been listening to the lies for too long. It's okay to break right now. God says, look up to me. He wants to lock eyes with you. Because healing comes from the Lord. And Jesus has eyes of fire. And his eyes will burn away every lie of the enemy. And you will be healed. You will be healed in the name of Jesus. Oh, Rekio! Oh, Rekio! No more! No more! I come to tell you that healing is on its way. Healing is on its way. God wants to heal you right now. You've been stuck in your mind. You've been stuck in your mind. But God wants to remove that right now. And he wants to give you the mind of Christ. Because there's peace with the mind of Christ. God says, I've seen what you've been through. I've heard the cries that you've cried to me. But today I want you to hear my cry. Today I want you to lift your hands and hear the cry of the Lord. You've cried to him, but he wants to cry to you right now. He wants to cry to you and show you his love. Because when he cries, he doesn't cry out of emotion or hurt, but he cries out of love. And he cries with a loud voice saying that he loves you, daughter.
Hello, my name is Ryan Colley. I'm International Evangelist and Administrative Vice President of Revival for Christ Club International Ministries. We'd like to thank you so much for tuning into our program today. And if you would like to help us take revival around the world to our friends in Honduras, Mexico, Singapore, and Malaysia, this is how you can do it. First off, you can send in your checks or money orders to 1005 Southwest 4th Street in Moore, Oklahoma, 73160. You can also call in with credit card at 405-793-1777. That's 405-793-1777. And finally, you can do it through the Cash App. That's money sign RFC ROAR. That's money sign RFC ROAR. Thanks in advance for helping us take the flame around the world. Remember, we are a ministry with a vision built on a plan, the Word of God.